The history of warfare is the history of firepower. In war fighting, the advantage has always been with the side which has been able to concentrate the most firepower in the right place at the right time. The concentrated firepower of the longbow, the rifle, the cannon, have been the decisive factor in the art of war over the last six centuries. But for the last 30 years, strategic warfighting has effectively relied on only one weapon, the guided missile. Over the years, both the United States and the Soviet Union have made their missiles faster, more accurate, better hidden, but their purpose has remained the same. To deliver a nuclear warhead. For the last 30 years, the world has lived under the doctrine of MAD, mutually assured destruction. For 30 years, this doctrine has assumed that while both sides may learn to protect their missiles, neither side can effectively protect their populations. Our cities, our people, remain the ultimate hostage. However, this 30-year era of mutually assured destruction may have ended on March 23rd, 1983.
Let me share with you a vision of the future which offers hope. It is that we embark on a program to counter the awesome Soviet missile threat with measures that are defensive. I know this is a formidable technical task, one that may not be accomplished before the end of this century. Yet current technology has attained a level of sophistication where it's reasonable for us to begin this effort.
I am Dr. Stephen Bardwell of the Fusion Energy Foundation. In the speech you just heard, President Reagan challenged American scientists to develop a series of revolutionary new technologies, technologies of high-intensity laser beams, particle beams, and pulses of high-intensity microwaves. These beams concentrate so much energy that they are able to destroy a ballistic missile at a distance of 1,000 miles at the speed of light. These technologies have been under intensive research in both the United States and the Soviet Union for the past 20 years. At the point that these technologies are perfected, they will not only provide a solution to the problem of nuclear annihilation, but they will also revolutionize every aspect of our lives, the way that industry produces things, the way that we produce energy, and the way that we communicate with each other. In the program that you're about to see, we will review the scientific basis for these beam technologies, both their military and civilian aspects. These beam technologies, we believe, represent the most revolutionary development in the 20th century. Laser beam technologies have many applications besides their use in military defense. Today, there are hundreds of different kinds of lasers in use in industry, research, and medicine. In fact, the laser is only the most recent development in man's long struggle to control the electromagnetic spectrum of radiant energy in more and more coherent forms. Although radiant energy exists all around us, man can only directly sense energy in the infrared and visible parts of the spectrum.
Man started by exploiting this section of the spectrum, the infrared section, using heat from fire. He then began to control visible light. In the second century BC, the Greek scientist Archimedes concentrated sunlight with large mirrors. He used these devices to set fire to the sails of attacking Roman ships in the first successful beam weapon. Man developed extensive uses for visible light: mirrors, lenses, then telescopes, and finally microscopes. But although man could use these tools for investigation and communication, he could still not use visible light to do work. Throughout the 19th and 20th centuries, science has been devoted to exploring the invisible parts of the electromagnetic spectrum: radio waves, microwaves, through to X-rays and cosmic rays. But until recently, we have been unable to use these kinds of radiation to do work, and have still relied on infrared radiation. In the early 1960s, American and Soviet scientists simultaneously developed the laser, a machine which can take electromagnetic energy in any form and focus it into a coherent beam whose light waves are all of the same wavelength.
The first laser took a burst of incoherent white light and produced a beam at the red end of the visible spectrum. This first laser led to a series of breakthroughs in man's development of the ability to control all parts of the electromagnetic spectrum, first in the red, then blue, ultraviolet, and in the future, in the X-ray band. The shorter the wavelength of these beams, the more concentrated the energy that they produce, and the more work they can create out of the same amount of energy. The most powerful form of energy obtainable by man today is produced by these beams of short wavelength laser light. beams concentrated enough to destroy ballistic missiles at thousands of miles distance.
American scientists are working right now on many of these advanced types of lasers. These new systems demand extremely concentrated input energy, available today only from nuclear sources.
Dr. John Cox, professor at the University of Florida and a researcher at RTS Labs, has been doing research on the family of nuclear-pumped lasers. Dr. Cox, would you tell us the state of research on these nuclear-pumped lasers?
Actually, there's a wide variety of nuclear-powered directed energy devices. There are explosion-driven systems, which could utilize the intense radiation produced from the detonation to energize a laser, or in which the radiation is simply focused or concentrated by means of waveguides or concentrators. There are also reactor-driven systems. Among the reactor-driven systems, there are nuclear power lasers in which radiation produced in the core is used to directly energize a laser, or in which certain metastable radioisotopes can be produced and isolated in the case of the gamma ray laser.
Dr. Cox, your own research has been concentrated in another area of nuclear reactor-powered lasers. Could you tell us in general what that technology looks like?
Well, the system I'm trying to develop uses radiation produced directly in the core, a variety of nuclear reactors that operate at very high temperature. Most nuclear power plants that you see today make heat from the nuclear energy. These types of reactors I'm working with, the nuclear energy is converted to light in the core, and I'm using this optical radiation to pump a laser system.
What would be the implications of using a nuclear-powered laser for space basing?
Well, most space systems are limited by the actual weight of the system. And certainly with a chemical system, you're limited by the amount of fuel that you can carry along. Now, for space-based lasers, I'm trying to take advantage of the fact that a nuclear fuel can store a million times as much energy as a chemical form of energy.
The most interesting and exciting of these advanced laser technologies is the X-ray laser. In its military application, the X-ray laser provides an almost perfect anti-ballistic missile defense because it's cheap, lightweight, and small. But the civilian applications of the X-ray laser are even more exciting. Already, the first generation of X-ray laser technologies have been applied in the construction of computer components and precision machinery. But scientists believe that the medical applications of the X-ray laser will be even more interesting. The X-ray laser allows the construction of a new kind of microscope called the X-ray laser holograph. The X-ray laser holograph provides detailed pictures at the molecular level of processes going on in the human cells. These processes can be used for the diagnosis and treatment of cancer, aging, and immune diseases. For these reasons, the X-ray laser is under intensive research in the United States. Can you summarize the status of research on detonation-driven X-ray lasers?
Well, there's a great deal of technological hurdles which have to be overcome before such a system can be deployed. Basically, there's a constant of nature in which, as you go into the shorter wavelength regions of the spectrum, the pumping power required to drive these systems increases to the fourth power of this wavelength. Now, the reactor or the explosion-driven system certainly has the capability of producing the power. But now you need to have a material and a laser medium which can withstand this energy input. So at this point in time, although in theory the system is straightforward, there's a lot of materials problems and certain other technologies which has to be developed in order for the system to be deployable.
Do you have any idea of how long or what kind of what level of scientific effort would be required to make that system work?
Well, I would go so far as to say that the issues that we have to overcome are certainly no more involved or difficult than those faced by the Manhattan Project team when they developed the first nuclear explosives.
The U.S. Department of Defense has been researching the military applications of lasers since the late 1960s, although on a relatively small scale. This is the Airborne Laser Laboratory, operated by the U.S. Air Force. It is armed with a chemical laser substantially less powerful than the types which we have been discussing. Over the last 5 years, this weapon has been successfully tested against drone aircraft and small missiles. Here is a drone being hit by a laser burst. In May 1983, the Air Force lab achieved some of its most spectacular results. That was a Sidewinder missile, traveling at approximately 2,000 miles an hour, being destroyed by airborne laser.
Test results like these and the current state of scientific research has convinced most experts that it is possible to build a complete defense against ballistic missiles. There have been many proposals for such a complete defense system, and almost all of them involve the idea of a layered defense, the combination of a number of different technologies to provide a complete defensive capability. Here is how such a system would work.
Suppose an enemy launch of thousands of ballistic missiles, each with several nuclear warheads. The key to a full defense is to get as many of these missiles as possible while they are in their ascent phase. The best first layer of such a system would be bomb-powered X-ray lasers. These X-ray devices could be quickly positioned on the warning of an attack. Each such device would be capable of generating 50 to 100 independently targeted bolts of energy. It is estimated that 100 such weapons could knock out 90% of an incoming missile bombardment. The remaining 10% of the missiles could be attacked in space by lasers which are probably less powerful than the X-rays, but faster firing. One viable option is to station satellites in space equipped with aiming devices and large mirrors. Lasers would fire from Earth, probably from a mountaintop where the atmosphere is thin. These two defensive layers would destroy 99% of the attacking missiles. The few warheads which leaked through would have to be taken out by what military men call point defense. The problem with a point defense beam is that it must be strong enough to move through the thick lower atmosphere without losing its killing punch. Even the lasers we have so far described would not be adequate for point defense. However, newly released information suggests that the best point defense would be an accelerator. This is not a laser. It is a stream of subatomic particles, like electrons, which have been accelerated to nearly the speed of light. Those flashes you see on your screen are bolts of over 4.5 million electron volts being generated by the ETA, an electron beam at the Lawrence Livermore Laboratory in California. This is the ATA, the Advanced Test Accelerator, also located at Livermore. The ATA is 10 times more powerful than the ETA. It is capable of pulsing over 50 million electron volts. As you can see, the ATA is housed in a building with a door at one end. This is so that the ATA can be tested against targets in the open air.
So we see that all the components of a beam defense system are either in the experimental stage or beyond. However, some scientists have questioned the feasibility of a beam defense system, and considerable debate has broken out over beams in the United States.
Although most of the leading spokesmen for both sides are physicists, the physics of beam weapons are largely not at issue.
Mr. Charles Stevens, one of my colleagues at the Fusion Energy Foundation, has been doing research on beam defense systems for 8 years. Chuck, can you summarize the objections that have been made on a scientific basis to a beam defense system?
Well, most of them have been of a character of mixing oranges with apples. For example, some people have objected that lasers cannot propagate through the atmosphere, though in most cases we would propagate lasers through space where there is no atmosphere or in the upper atmosphere. If we look at the actual status of where things stand today, we find that even with conventional lasers, we are able to meet the requirements needed for intercepting offensive nuclear weapons. If you look at this chart, you'll see that we're already very, very close, if not there, in terms of what's needed, what's required. For example, the pointing accuracy is already there and deployed. We are quickly developing the sorts of tracking accuracy that we need, the mirror size, the stability of the mirror in terms of its ability to reflect the powerful laser beam, and also in terms of laser power.
Chuck, what about the criticism that beam weapons will be too expensive?
You see, it's very simply the fact that for the last three decades, the reason why offensive nuclear weapons have dominated everything is that you could destroy billions of dollars worth of property with a weapon costing a few million dollars, and being able to be carried to the enemy's territory with a vehicle that was propelled with rockets, chemical energy, that couldn't be intercepted except with other rockets with chemical energy. Now we've been able to harness, through advances in fusion and plasma and laser research, we have been able to harness nuclear energy into directed forms of beams that travel at the speed of light. These don't need chemical rockets to carry them to the target. So things are going to get much easier. And our ability to just cheaply destroy thousands of offensive nuclear weapons with one defensive system.
Many critics have claimed that the development of a beam defense would destabilize the balance of power between the United States and the Soviet Union and begin a new arms race. This criticism has been most recently voiced by the Soviet Union. However, while we cannot deal with these political questions in detail, the Soviet Union, it must be noted, was the first to begin research on beam weapons, continues that research now, and at this point spends between 3 and 5 times as much on their beam research as does the United States. In fact, in 1962, in his book Soviet Military Strategy, the following was written by Marshal V. Sokolovsky.
Possibilities are being studied for the use against rockets of a stream of high-speed neutrons. Special attention is devoted to lasers, death rays. It is considered that in the future, any missile and satellite can be destroyed with powerful lasers. In addition to the Marshal's statement, this diagram describing a laser missile defense system appeared in an English language Soviet publication. Both Sokolovsky's statement and the diagram have disappeared from subsequent editions, presumably because of security reasons. American intelligence sources report that the Soviet Navy has already mounted anti-aircraft lasers on the recently built battlecruiser Kirov, and it is believed that the Soviets have begun building massive radar installations of the type needed for anti-missile beam defenses. It is safe to say that the U.S. military believes beam research to be vital. It has been claimed by beam critics, however, that our European allies are not so excited as we are in this attempted shift in strategy.
Colonel Marc Genest, known as the father of the French neutron bomb, is a 25-year veteran of the French Army. He's also a well-known commentator and analyst on European nuclear strategy. Colonel Genest, what is your assessment of the impact of a beam defense on nuclear strategy in general?
This is a very interesting question. Let's suppose that we want to build deterrence on something more intelligent than the MAD strategy, in which it was vulnerability which was supposed to be the cornerstone of security. To get rid of war, or to achieve deterrence, you have to get rid of offense. This is obvious. And offense has two components. Roughly speaking, infantry, men in tanks or in armored cars, in planes, and rockets. These are the two components. We can very easily get rid of the threat of men, of land force, using modern nuclear technology, such as the neutron bomb. Even the Russians are awfully vulnerable. Men are awfully vulnerable to neutron flux. So much for this threat. What was left was the other form of offense, rockets. And if you offer us the hope to get rid of this other form of offense, so much the better. Defense wins. And that's why if you add to that the capability of killing rockets, that's it. War is dead as an instrument of policy. They have to find something else to bother us. They might, they have a lot of tricks in their bag, but at least Europe and the West will be more confident and will not be vulnerable to their blackmail, their military blackmail. I think all this is very simple. Let's play technology rather than the old trick of gathering young men with bows and arrows or bayonets to stop the enemy. We have it now. Let's play it.
Colonel, a number of critics of the president's proposal have claimed that the development of a beam defense by the United States would decouple the United States from Europe and sever the North Atlantic Alliance on the question of nuclear war. Can you give your reaction to that general idea and what the feeling in European nuclear analyst circles is on this question?
If you build a comprehensive defense against rockets, including the Western Alliance, I don't see why the European would not accept with pleasure the end of this threat.
Many experts believe, though, that in 20 years, the greater impact of a beam defense program will not be military, but rather civilian. The spin-offs from these laser technologies, much like the spin-offs from the Apollo program to put a man on the moon, will generate tremendous economic benefit. It is estimated that the NASA program to put a man on the moon generated $14 of economic output for every dollar spent on its research. Probably a greater impact will be felt from a beam defense program. In both civilian and military applications, efficiency depends on energy concentration. The key question is the power density achievable. In industry, the lowest power densities are achieved by burning coal and oil to produce heat. Higher power densities come from burning uranium to produce electricity. But the highest power densities come only with the ability to produce the fourth state of matter, a plasma. Beam technologies of the sort we've discussed are the key to unlocking the plasma state of matter. Matter so hot that the electrons have been stripped away from the nuclei to produce a new electrically charged state of matter. These plasmas are the key to high-efficiency industrial processing.
We now smelt steel using blast furnaces driven by infrared radiation. But here is a prototype of a furnace where a plasma is used. A large-scale version would be substantially more economical than any current steel furnace. Other things become more economical at higher energy densities as well. Currently, most of America's energy comes from coal. The turning of coal into steam and then into electricity is about 35% efficient, and we have to worry about pollution. If we used a plasma to burn coal, in a technology called magnetohydrodynamics, or MHD, we could achieve efficiencies of 70%.
Dr. Daniel Swalem is manager of military applications for MHD for the Avco Everett Research Laboratory in Everett, Massachusetts. Dr. Swalem, what are the advantages of MHD for production of electricity?
Magnetohydrodynamics, or MHD as it's often called, has two principal advantages for the production of electricity. The first one is a greater efficiency. The second one is a lower level of pollutants emitted from the power plant itself.
What's special about MHD that gives it these advantages?
The higher efficiency advantage comes about because of a higher temperature in the MHD process that allows it to produce electricity, that is more electricity, from a given amount of chemical energy than many other processes.
Lasers bring these kinds of high energy regimes to a fine focus, making lasers the most efficient means of welding, cutting metal, etc. The use of lasers and particle beams in industry has already begun. As we master the more powerful types of lasers, we can begin to mass produce them, bring them into industry, and further transform our economy. The next generation of lasers will also be crucial for the exploration of another frontier, space. Dr. Kraft Erika of the Space Global Corporation is one of the pioneers of the American space effort.
Well, one of the well-known potential applications is laser propulsion. In this case, laser power in the megawatt to gigawatt range is transmitted to a spacecraft to heat a reaction mass or provide effectively electric power for an ion propulsion system by using solar cells that are attuned to a suitable laser frequency. Another application involves the use of lasers to illuminate surface areas at night or in the far outer solar system for very high resolution imaging purposes. A third application generally involves remote probing of planetary atmospheres, wind speeds, temperatures, compositions, and that of course also applies to our Earth itself. This picture shows an example of thermionic ion powered spacecraft navigating in the vicinity of Pluto and illuminating points on the surface for high intensity illumination and for high resolution imaging. Laser beams as spectroscopic tools have a wide tunability from vacuum ultraviolet to far infrared. They can be highly monochromatic with high spectral brightness. They are coherent, that is, they can be tightly focused and collimated and can be interfered to provide intensity modulation. And they can be either continuous or pulsed. Now, these properties can be used for highly sensitive measurements of atmospheric pollutants, all of which have well-known absorption bands.
The most exciting spin-off of the beam revolution will be a technology for producing cheap, clean, and unlimited energy. As we master the plasma technologies you have seen, we will be in mastery of a process called nuclear fusion, which will allow us to produce electricity through the production of high-temperature plasmas. By replicating conditions similar to those at the surface of the sun, we will be able to produce pollution-free commercial electricity. While it would take another program to describe the details of nuclear fusion, many of the experiments you have seen in this program were not done in weapons laboratories, but were nuclear fusion experiments conducted by this country and others. I believe that the perfection of laser and particle beam technologies will represent the most profound change in modern society since the Renaissance. Throughout mankind's history, at every point that there was such a revolution in technology, a revolution in man's relation to nature, there was also a profound challenge to his cultural, political, and moral values. Such a challenge exists today. Many critics of the beam program have met this challenge by saying these technologies are impossible. Their ancestors said the same thing about electricity, about nuclear energy, even about space flight. Other critics of the beam program have said that these technologies are inadvisable. These pessimists fear that these technologies will be dangerous, that man is not mature enough to master politically or socially the technologies of laser and particle beams. I believe those pessimists are wrong. I would like to share with you my optimism about man's future if he has these technologies under his control. Because these technologies deal not only with the means by which war is fought, they not only neutralize the weapons of war, but they deal with the causes of war. They begin to address for the first time in man's history the basic questions of hunger, of energy, of housing, of the minimal standard of living that's necessary for a human life for every human being. These technologies, of course, do not provide that in themselves, but put to wise use, man with these technologies can truly deal with other men in a human way. Thank you.